So this column failure theory, the idea that the columns were the first thing that failed, was out of the box right away. But it has a lot of serious problems, like the fact that in order for the columns to fail, they would have to be elevated to such a high temperature, around 700 degrees Celsius, and even then, you wouldn't get a simultaneous failure like you'd need to bring down the buildings. But still, the steel would be glowing red hot. You'd have ongoing window breakage and big, bright, emergent red flames. But in the case of both towers, the fires, especially in the South Tower, were never that severe. This is the most severe they ever were, never even grew to the other side of the building. And so how could that produce this total precipitous collapse or weaken the columns to that point when there's no precedent for it? And in fact, studies that have been done on the effect of severe fires on uninsulated steel structure, such as one done by Corus Construction, found the highest temperatures in any of the steelwork was only 360 degrees Celsius in similar kinds of fires. Now that's a long way from 700 Celsius. But the most important thing to realize about any column failure theory is that it wouldn't level the towers. Any event, even if you could have fires that were so severe they somehow could compromise the strength of the steel and something would collapse, it wouldn't cause this straight down telescoping collapse like you see in the North Tower, because what happens is the top of the building just glides straight down into itself, maintaining symmetry. And the whole purpose of controlled demolition is to achieve that result, get the building to go straight down, which of course no natural event will induce, because for the building to fall down would require it to follow the path of maximum resistance. So because of the obvious deficiencies in the column failure theory, we were treated with the truss failure theory, which blames the failure of these web trusses, which held up the floor diaphragms, which were these rings that connected the core structures of the building to the perimeter structures. And supposedly according to Professor Eager of MIT, material scientist professor, there was an unzipping chain reaction of the connections of the trusses to the columns failing, and then the floors failing in a pancaking chain reaction, and just brought the whole building down. And it uses very deceptive techniques to sell this story. Like they have the schematic of the building in which the core structure of the building is replaced by a series of horizontal slabs rather than the vertical columns that were actually there. So all kinds of tricks to make you think that this could actually happen. The truss failure was most importantly endorsed by FEMA's report, the one that I was talking, that was the one that we had the American Society for Civil Engineers, volunteer engineers, coming up with this theory. And this theory isn't even believable at all, because even if you accept this idea of the floors pancaking, that would leave the columns standing, and the columns would have to fail too for the entire building to fail. And they say that there were tall freestanding portions of the exterior columns, and then they failed. But look, there's no tall freestanding columns anywhere. The columns are all, the only evidence you see of columns is little chunks of columns being hurled out in all directions. So they misrepresent the building too. FEMA and virtually all the reports, in one way or another, misrepresent the cores of these buildings, because the core is the thing that most obviously disproves this idea that the buildings could just fall straight down through themselves, because these could hold up several times the weight of the entire building. And they misrepresent it by calling it a service core, deceptive illustrations that imply that the core didn't even exist. Other more deceptive illustrations that show the core columns at a fraction of their actual dimensions. Other ones that show a column that's obviously not a core column, as if it is, it only has about half the dimensions. So in fact, the towers had these huge core structures. There's 47 steel box columns. They were 36 inches by 16 inches outside dimensions. And it invalidates the collapse theory, any of these collapse theories, because even if there was extensive damage to the outside of the building, it wouldn't have heated up, it wouldn't have caused enough damage to the core for that to fail simultaneously, and certainly couldn't have had both the core and the exterior all the columns failing simultaneously to produce these telescoping collapses that happened in both towers. The truss failure theory is basically a diversion, because it's this complicated theory of one kind of failure leading to another, and it was later replaced again by the column failure theory. So the most recent report we have is by the National Institute for Standards and Technology, which released a report just this year, and they've gone back to embrace the column failure theory. So they can't seem to decide whether they like the trusses to fail first or the columns to fail first. They keep going back and forth. But they don't begin to explain the total collapse of these buildings. Because think about it. These are the only examples of total progressive collapse, supposedly, ever observed, where a structure crushes itself starting from the top, and the crushing just goes all the way down the building and crushes the whole building to nothing. That's technically called top-down total progressive collapse, and there's not a single example of it outside of the alleged cases of the Twin Towers. Now, if you can't reproduce a phenomenon, then it's not scientific to say the phenomenon exists, because the scientific method says that you have to be able to reproduce a phenomenon in order for it to be real. So that was the portion of my talk, very abbreviated, describing what's wrong with the official theories. So I think the next two sections are more important because these are direct evidence of demolition, not just saying that they can't come up with an explanation. These features that were documented by the numerous photographs and videos taken of these events show that they had this explosiveness, all these features, like this, the blast waves were so intense that they just blew out the windows all throughout these financial center buildings that were 400 feet away from the nearest tower. It hurled debris, and like this is like 400 feet up in the tower, just explosively hurled in all directions, steel pieces being blown as far as 500 feet radially, all directions from the towers. Demolition squibs are features seen in controlled demolitions where puffs of dust suddenly emerge from the facade. And these are seen clearly in the North Tower. They're much more apparent when you watch a video, and these squibs just instantly pop out of the building with velocities of maybe 100 feet per second. They just shoot out of the building by 100 feet. And they're well below the area of complete destruction. So these couldn't possibly be caused by floors falling down and squeezing out air, because if that's the case, then what's generating all this pulverized concrete up here? The floors were the only concrete element in these buildings. And yet you have these high velocity gas ejections occurring as much as 20 stories below the zone where the whole building is just breaking up. The way I describe what happened to the towers is that I don't think you can get around calling these explosions. They exploded into these clouds of dust with steel hurling in all directions. And these explosions became 500 feet in diameter by the time they reached the ground. Actually, more like 800 feet in diameter. But the reason I think people don't think of them as explosions is because they occurred over a period of 15 seconds in either case. So there wasn't a particularly, like, normally people think of an explosion as you hear a loud crack, a bang, and then it's just that one event. But if you have, in the case of a demolition where you might have thousands of explosions that are all blending in, then you get one huge explosive event, but you don't hear any distinct explosions that's so much above the roar of it. The thing sounded like sort of like an ocean wave, just this incredibly loud roar. But incredibly explosive. The tops, I described them as mushrooming, because they blew out so far. This is the North Tower, and this distance here is about 120 feet. The tower is 207 feet across the face. So then this is only a few seconds into the collapse, and this stuff is being hurled out with a lot of lateral energy to be thrown that far out. And they mushroom, and this cloud just becomes larger and larger as it goes straight down to the ground. The symmetry is probably the most telling element. I spoke a little bit about that earlier, in that they followed the vertical axis of the building. The destruction followed the axis of the building in both cases all the way down, even in the case of the South Tower, where the top had started to lean for 2 seconds, and then it just disintegrated and just went all straight down to the ground.